long as that period of sitting. Okay. Raise your hand if you feel that was good. Okay. Raise your hand if you feel it was difficult. Difficult. Okay, some people. Difficult. Was the last segment of the sitting difficult? Maybe it was relaxing the first part, sending loving kindness to ourselves. Very easy. Feeling good. And then we bring forth the image of people suffering in anguish, and then genuinely wishing them to be free from suffering. Maybe that was difficult. Did you find that difficult? Raise your hand. Okay, maybe some people. Okay. So what we did was a combination of loving kindness and meditation on compassion. So Maitri and Karuna. That's the Sanskrit word. In Buddhism, loving kindness, in the Pali pronunciation would be metta, meditation, means it's a method to cultivate friendliness, connection, bringing joy to someone. Well, we did it, we send loving kindness to ourselves. We can do the same with different people in our lives. So loving kindness has this quality of bringing joy, happiness to ourselves or others. In Buddhism, compassion is the flip side of the coin. Loving kindness on the one side is bringing joy and happiness to yourself and others. Compassion is to alleviate suffering of self and others. Okay. So the ability to recognize and open ourselves, to avail ourselves in a vulnerable way to recognize the suffering. And the wish, the aspiration to do something about it. So these two sides work together, loving kindness and compassion. There needs to be a balance between the two. In order to experience genuine joy, not some temporary bliss, suffering must be removed, and causes of suffering must be alleviated. So otherwise, without doing that, meditation on compassion, loving kindness is just wishful thinking. So the way we did it was we ground ourselves first. In order to take any action, we have to cultivate the ability to relax, to ground ourselves. And from that connection to earth, that recognition that the body belongs to earth, just like everyone else, we send good wishes, right? Well wishes to ourselves or others. But that's not sufficient. In order to truly help ourselves or others, we have to learn to recognize suffering and causes of suffering. And that's what we did the second part, a little taste of it. So how many of you when you practice the second part, I ask all of you to bring up that image of someone suffering. How many of you were able to do that? Raise your hand. Okay, can you raise your hands higher so I can see? Okay. And how did that make you feel in your body? Your experience. Was it uneasy when you see someone suffering? Raise your hand. Were you able to relax into that uneasiness, ambivalent feeling? Did that experience allow you to draw out within you the wish for you to be as wherever you were meditating on, to be at peace, to feel safe, right? That's the number one. That's the first phrase, safety. Right? What's the second one? Health, right? Safe, health. Third one, happiness, and being at peace. In other words, you can't be at peace if you are not happy. You can't be unhappy. You can't be happy if you are not healthy, if your body is going through sickness for ordinary people. Right? And you can't feel the sense of health and well-being if you don't even feel safe. And I want to segue here, and we'll open up for a Q&A later, to social engagement. Social engagement. Our practice, Buddha Dharma. Initially, when we come to practice, probably it's because we feel the need to find some peace and clarity within ourselves. Maybe we're stressed, we feel anxiety, we've experienced some pain, suffering. So we want to find some method to find ourselves, to be able to experience a modicum of happiness. But just like us, everyone is trying to do that. But the world that we live in, it's unfair. And we must be able to recognize that, embrace that. Of course, we could shelter ourselves, distract ourselves, look away from the injustice of the world, all the things that's not fair. One could do that. Living in our own hermetically sealed bubble, right? Construct of our own minds, in which we block out everything that's unpleasant. Now, some people live like this. Meditation. Does the opposite. And by meditation, I mean Buddhist meditation. Buddhist meditation is like excavation. It's not zapping into peace, bliss. It's not about that. It's about opening ourselves up to see within ourselves the dis-ease, the habit tendencies, the causes of them, vexations, discriminations, to understand these patterns and be able to accept that it's part of us and work with them, eventually to let go of them. So this I call this fourfold process of exposing, embracing, transforming, and letting go. It works with our anguish, our suffering, the causes, and transform them into opportunities for us to deepen our insight and to bring forth our innate resource. This resource that's within each and every one of you, and that is your freedom. That you have the capacity to free yourself. But as a person, go deep into oneself and begin to understand the mechanisms of discrimination within ourselves, our biased views, our self-referential ideas, vexations, and begin to work with them, one begins to recognize also that everyone else is going through the same thing, is plagued by their suffering, their vexations. And sometimes these vexations come from external conditions. So exposing ourselves, we also, in that process, begin to open to the world. We see the interconnectedness with all things. Someone else suffering, it will affect us. Our discriminations, explicit or implicit, affects the world, our small world, and the larger world around us. So, all of these things are part of the practice. Fourfold practice of exposing, embracing, accepting, right? Transforming, and alleviating, letting them go, going beyond them to bring forth our freedom and the freedom of everyone else. So in terms of social engagement, it becomes a natural extension of the work of our practice. It's just a natural extension. This is Buddhist meditation. So some people bring to Buddha Dharma their own notions of what practice is. Almost like an escapist attitude. I want to be happy, I don't want to see that, I want to avoid this, avoid that. Our tolerance level to suffer, very, very low pain. A little bit of discomfort, we want to move physically. Your leg pains, for example. Other people's discomfort, we're not so sensitive to it. We're not sensitive to the ways in which our own minds work, our own speech affects the world, and our own actions. Right? So as we expose practice, we become familiar, and we become to take that into part of our practice, that is practice of Buddha Dharma. So there is no, in the Buddhist languages, there's no kind of one-to-one corresponding term called meditation, actually. Something close to it is called bhavana, which means cultivation, as in self-cultivation. But it also has this nuance of practicing something, amending, correcting, realigning. So it has all these nuances. That's what meditation is. So the Buddhist meditation is about self-cultivation. How? Working with it, the self. Changing, amending, transforming. So all that is included. So it's not tied to a fixed bodily posture, like all of us, sitting in meditation. That's part of it. But practice is not tied to a posture. It's not tied to a particular act. It's extended to every aspect of life. So practice extends to our whole field of sense faculties, sense realms, sight, sound, smell, taste, touch, thought, all the auric experiences. So therefore, for that reason, what we deem as in contemporary time as, you know, socially engaged Buddhism, right? This is a catchphrase now, right? Socially engaged Buddhism. It's really a modern idea, right? Because the opposite of that, should we assume that Buddhism of the previous era is really not socially engaged? It's kind of self-referentially about my own liberation, hermetically sealed from the social. It's just about me, I, mine. No. If that were true, Shakyamuni Buddha would not have toiled, exhausted himself, walking barefoot for 40 years teaching people, would not have the compassion that drove him to share the teachings. He would just be hermetically sealed from the world in his bliss, right? Not the spirit of Buddha Dharma. And his first five disciples, once they have tasted liberation, the first thing he said to them is, you five, go in five directions, spread the teachings. He didn't say, okay, now you can just relax, enter nirvana, you know, conceal yourself, divorce yourself from the world, and just stay in the forest. No. First thing he said, go each in your own direction, share the teachings. Why? Because this is a natural extension. Just like we experience suffering, everyone experiences suffering. And all of us are interconnected. So, it's a natural extension. And a kind of measure of our practice. The shallowness and the depth, it's a measure of our practice. So that the actions of our body, speech, and mind, and its connection to the world, everything are ingrained in to be the path. For example, in the Chan Zen tradition, when we eat mindfully, of course, concentration. But the way we treat our bowl, the way we treat our bowl, what we have the food, it's actually an example of this socially engaged, although in pre-modern time, they don't have such a word. You know, this is a kind of Western idea, compartmentalizing what is socially engaged, what is not. Right? This is very foreign in pre-modern time. In East Asia, the way we treat our bowl after we eat, we use water, sometimes tea, pour in the bowl, and we use our utensils, chopsticks, leave a piece of the vegetable like a sponge and wash the bowl and then drink the water. The practice of one, frugality. Two, responsibility. Three, consideration. Four, environmental protection. How? The bowl. You know, most people, when they eat, they leave all the crumbs and all the leftovers. Who's going to take care of it? Yeah, the dishwasher. Someone else take care of it. We made the mess. The food that we have come from the benefit of patrons, donors, the benefit of others. It is other people who sustain our practice. So the practice of frugality, we don't waste the food. And we take care of the traces that we left behind. Our own crumbs. By the time we bring our bowl to the dishwasher, they don't have to take care of your crumbs. Nowadays, with the advent of dish detergent, pre-modern time is just salt. They use salt to clean it. Dish detergent, they just need just a little bit to clean your bowl because basically it's spotless clean. Does that make sense? Right. Protect the environment. Protect the environment. Same thing where we carry ourselves when we go to the bathroom, the different spaces that we find ourselves in. Most people will leave trace behind. Wherever they go, they just make the place dirty. Right? You go to the bathroom, the counter is wet, you wash your hands, and you don't bother cleaning the counter. How many of you bother, you go to a public bathroom, and you clean your hand, you got some water splashing over, bother to clean the counter? Raise your hand. How many of you? Who do you think is going to clean it? Oh, the janitor. It's his job to clean it. So our mess, someone else to take care of. Chan practice, Zen practice, one Chan master, Master Dongshan. Dongshan says, someone asked him, what's practice like? He says, the tracks of the birds. Tracks. Now, it's not like airplane going through the sky has a smoke from the jet engine. You see the trail. Do you see trails? Do you see trails when birds fly by in the sky? No. Leave no trace behind. Practice. But we even go beyond that. Not only all the places that we go, we make it clean. We're like a spring breeze. Everywhere we go, not only do we not make a mess, everywhere we go, when we leave, the place is better. That's the spirit of Chan. Translating that to our modern time, we live in a place of social, political unrest, injustice. Pain or suffering are everywhere, driven by different ideologies. And there are people, historically, oppressed, silenced. They are the subaltern, the voiceless, the marginalized. And they are systemic mechanisms in place in the realm of education, in the realm of housing, in the realm of welfare, in the realm of mass media, in politics. That systemically silence certain people, privilege others. Those of us who are privileged, we don't see this because we're the privileged. The sense of entitlement that we feel. Right? Assumptions that we have. Automatic. Some people don't have this privilege. The social networks, our ability to access healthcare, access the places that we want to go, different spaces. Some people don't have. Yet we live in such a wealthy country. There are people that are starving. No food to eat. They are the marginalized. How do we avail ourselves to see? We need to expose. We need to embrace, recognize this, accept this. We can't shelter ourselves. We need to change, transform. And we need to let go. Or, in this case, liberate. Liberate. So, for example, there are historic, systemic mechanisms, real lived experience from birth to death of certain people, sector of the society, continually oppressed. They don't have access. Like all of you, who are privileged, sitting on nice meditation cushions every Thursday at 6 p.m. We have a luxury of all these teachers coming in, giving teachings, guided meditation. There are people that don't have access to this. There are people that are driving, jogging. How many of you jog? Raise your hand. Ah, you jog. Do you feel safe when you jog? There are people that jog. They have to watch out because they may be killed. There are people that go to grocery stores buying something. Driving, pulled over by the police because of the color of their skin. And when they jog in a neighborhood, because the color of their skin, they're questioned. chased down with a shotgun, 4x4, truck, two men, because he doesn't belong here. Shoot him dead. There are people that don't have the basic necessity of safety, health. The way we meditated, happiness. They live in fear. They are not at peace. It's all around us. We are experiencing a wake-up call ever since last summer of the murder of George Floyd and all that preceded him. For centuries. But it's usually not in the mass media. Why? They don't have a voice. They don't have a spotlight. It's concealed, tucked away. But these things happen all the time. We're at the age of racial reckoning. We need to recognize, embrace that. So the organization that I founded, this is not a plug for Dharma Relief, by the way. This is just one response. There are many Buddhist responses. Dharma Relief was founded during the pandemic with a shortage of PPEs, personal protective equipment, you know, like FDA-approved masks and so on, raise funds. Sent to hospitals, hundreds of hospitals. All the Buddhist centers come together to do this. That was Dharma Relief, Initiative 1. Just at the close of that initiative, murder of George Floyd happened. So the different Buddhist centers, Dharma teachers came together and decided, we have to address this issue. We have to respond. It's a natural outpour of our practice. So, but we also knew this must be led by Black Dharma teachers. This Dharma Relief 2, second initiative project. Why? We can't hijack this to be, because most of the Dharma Relief, with the exception of one, are white Dharma teachers from Vipassana tradition, Insight Meditation, Tibetan, Rinzai Zen, Soto, you know, all different tradition. It's a reflection of, you know, Buddha Dharma in North America, right? Outside of the ethnic Buddhist, you know, like the Chinese temple in Chinatown, the Japanese, Jodo Shinshu, take care of the Japanese immigrants, second generation, third generation. Outside of the ethnic Buddhist communities, mainstream, which doesn't have a voice in North America, the mainstream Buddhist in America are the privileged white. They have the leisure to buy a cushion, to sit. They have the resources to do that. And they have the magazines, mainstream Buddhist magazines. Who's running them? White people. So who do they amplify? The voice? White people. I'm not saying white people is, you know, I'm not against white people. I'm just saying the state of the field. This is what it is. So naturally, reflecting the white majority of North America is mostly white, so Buddhist centers are naturally mostly white. Okay. We knew that we need to find Black Dharma teachers. We need to amplify their voice We need to address the racial trauma through training of resiliency. That's through therapy and also grounded in Buddha Dharma. This is the work of Dharma Relief 2, DR2. So we need to recognize this work. This is only one aspect of it. Right? Healing racial relations has two aspects. One, those who are marginalized, support them, amplify their Dharma work so that Black Dharma teachers, so they can work with the Black communities. But they, comparatively speaking, they lack the resources, whether it's financial resources or interpersonal connections, resources to the privileged. So we need financial support of them so they can do their Dharma work. Does that make sense? Yeah. Another aspect is, so you can call that, you know, healing racial trauma, right? Centuries of this trauma. You can't be white person going to Black community. I'm the white savior that's going to help you. Or the Chinese, Asian savior is going to come here. And no, it's got to be, they have to, practitioners, all of you, you need to see your own possibility. You need to see people that look like you, that practice Dharma. Does that make sense? The Black community, they need to see Black Dharma teachers as exemplars, teaching, integrating Buddha Dharma in their lives and coming out to express their agency, to share the teachings. So we need to amplify the Black Dharma teachers, support them, raise funds to support them. Second half of this is the white spaces. White spaces. Dharma spaces. We need to wake up as well to recognize the implicit, unintentional, part of it is just cultural. The shared sensibility, repertoire of shared practices, customs, sensibility of the privileged. How that is not providing a safe, welcoming space for people of color. I'll give you one example. You know, Zen, for example, Zen, solemn, you know, silent. You go to the Dharma Center, you can. Everyone's walking around like a samurai, right? Silent. That, it's very awkward for people of color, or for Black people specifically. Their culture is different. Their culture is about connection, singing, dancing, drumming, and, you know, hallelujah, right? Their services are very different. So in that space, they feel very awkward. Now, I'm not saying that, you know, the Zen centers must start dancing and singing and, you know, expressing the Dharma in that way. But we have to understand the sensibility, the cultural differences, the Black bodies in spaces, how do they navigate? Once we have that sensibility, we can provide that welcoming space. Reach out to, right? Welcome. Come to the center. You know, come say, here's what we have, this is what we do. You know. So they feel welcomed. Yeah. We have to do outreach to black communities, but the non-black Dharma centers. Very few black people or Latinx people exist in those majority Dharma centers. So we have to do more work. We have to understand. You know, implicitly, just by going about the way we always do things, makes people uncomfortable. Yeah. It's not anyone's fault. It's just how things are, causes and conditions. So sometimes we have to inject change in the causes and conditions to heal the racial tension that we are experiencing. The things we say, the actions that we take. So all of that, you don't think, oh, that's not Buddha Dharma. Some people say, I just want to go to center to meditate. I don't see politics and social issues as have any space in Dharma centers. That's wrong. So you think Dharma is just sitting meditation like a rock, not moving? That's Buddha Dharma? Or certain actions, behaving? No. Dharma is your mind, is your life, every aspect of our discrimination, mechanisms of habit tendencies sometimes generates suffering for ourselves and for those around us. So living in this world, we have to understand the causes and conditions of the world. And in order for change to happen, we see it as practice. We recognize suffering. We want to bring loving kindness to the world. Yes, metta. The flip side of the coin. We have to be able to recognize suffering and the causes and see if there's something that we can do to change. We have to see how implicitly, unintentionally, sometimes we are contributors to other people's suffering. And that's what taking up responsibility. So where we place our money, where we buy things, we have to be conscious. Who are we supporting? How are we supporting? We don't live in a hermetically sealed bubble. Every action that we take has repercussions. We have to make sure our intention stems out of being grounded in practice, free from vexations. So we don't follow vexations. So we have to see it within ourselves. Then we can recognize what the world needs, what can be done. And our resources, all of our actions, we can choose who to amplify, who to support, how to support, how to be an ally. All that is part of Dharma practice. This Dharma, this Buddha Dharma, is alive. It is your life. It's not separate from the places that you go, the choices that you make. Your path unfolds in every one of your decisions. Does that make sense? Yeah? So, where is Buddha Dharma? Is it in books? Does it only exist on Thursday evenings like this occasion? That's where teaching it. It may begin that way. It may begin that way. When we go deeper, when we avail ourselves to this path, the path will start to open up. And all living beings becomes our path. That's what practice is. So if you want to know more about Dharma Relief 2, DR2, please Google it, find our website, share it with people, as many people as you can, and educate yourself. I ran a whole year-long series of anti-racism at the Tallahassee Chan Center here. Everything is recorded. All the talks by different scholars. So in terms of intersectionality, I invited scholars from different aspects of our life, from history to kind of trauma to social workers to people in the educational system, health sector, to the criminal justice system, scholars, right, from all over North America to give talks and to provide multiple angles tackling this problem of racism. So to open our blinders, right, so we expose, we see, avail ourselves, embrace, and do the work. So search that. Tallahassee Chan Center, you know, click on the YouTube icon. There's a whole series of talks. You know, to understand, educate yourself. Educate yourself. This life, is a learning process. Continue to learn. Continue to bring out the resources within, the compassion within, to help yourself, help everyone around. Right? As Buddhists, we don't see the world and others from the perspective of victims and perpetrators. Not like the people that go on strike, you know, victim. No, those are the perpetrators. And then this oppositional view. The perpetrators are the victims. You know, sometimes. Right? And the victims, sometimes they become perpetrators. Why is it that there's crime? Because suffering. Suffering, inability to access resources. They don't have the fundamental privilege of just feeling safe, access to education or whatever. So the boundaries are blurred. All beings suffering, all beings need help, all of us interconnected. The world brings out our resources. And we ourselves belong to the world. You are me. Those people that are dying, those people that are suffering, they are me. And I am them. They are our path. With the Dharma. This is the live, living Dharma that money can't buy. It's everywhere around, continually exposing, revealing themselves. It's a matter of us opening our blinders and see. Okay, so socially engaged Buddhism, Buddha Dharma, these are, to me, they're synonymous. Buddha Dharma is life. Life is not just, oh, it's just the meditation life. You know? It's just the life on Thursday evenings when I sit in meditation in a particular posture. That is Buddha Dharma. No. Life, all the ups and downs, all the histories, all the dimensions, complex dimensions of life. That is our arena. That is our zendo. That is the Bodhi mandala, the site of awakening. Just like Shakyamuni Buddha. His site of awakening. Yes, under the Bodhi tree. But what propelled him to do that? Suffering of people in his life. In his life. So his Bodhi mandala is this world of samsara. The greater the impetus of compassion, the greater the awakening. The narrow, self-referential, selfish way to practice, the little tiny insight, maybe. Right? So, life and death, everything in between. That's our path. So I'll conclude here. Can entertain some questions.